Jealousy, you tripped me up. Jealousy, you brought me down. You bring me sorrow, you cause me pain. Jealousy, when will you let go?
The first thing that he used to try and start his independent phase was, ironically, another Shakespeare film to follow Macbeth, his take on Othello in 1951.
Yes, this is Shakespeare's statement on jealousy. Othello is Venice's greatest soldier, but also being a Moor, Othello is an outsider. And he marries Desdemona, daughter of a very powerful senator, but is plagued by suspicions of infidelity planted by his two-faced and maniacal underling, Iago. To say the least, he does not take it well.
I'm going to admit that I came in from a perspective that this is the only version of Othello that I have ever seen. My previous experiences with it have entirely been upon the board game. So I can only judge on what this movie is doing, which is does not have the longest running time, and I can see how there could potentially be more machinations that maybe were cut or were not able to be filmed. But my impressions on here is that in Othello, I think Welles was deliberately trying to open things up, and it opens up in like the most drastic way possible, because there's many things that are set right on the seashore, set out in the outdoors at this really large like castle. So it's trying to take the story in a more expansive setting, at least.
Well, the theatricality is gone, and the way this is filmed is really jaw-dropping. Instead of the sets that were used for Macbeth, now Welles is on location, and on location everywhere. It took him 3 years to shoot, and it was filmed in Venice, Tuscany, Rome, and Morocco, because he would have to shoot bits of it, make more money, and then shoot more bits of it. So you could have a scene where somebody turns a corner 1 year in one country and is shown again 2 years later. And the fact that he is able to make most of this invisible is a testament to the filmmaking. Now, the one thing that is not invisible is the dubbing issue, because he didn't have access to the same actors over all these periods. So a lot of the dialogue, especially from the minor actors, needed to be dubbed and were often dubbed by Welles himself. But this movie made me kind of think of a question, because I've seen a number of other Othello films and productions, and I have to ask, is there a difference between great cinema and great Shakespeare, capturing what the film is about? While there's no question the gorgeousness, the richness of the visuals here are something to behold, I don't think he tells the narrative in as strong a way as some other productions and some other films, because of two things. First of all, in his own performance, is very low key. Othello expresses his jealousy by going into massive rages.
Oh, okay.
And Welles generally avoids those. He keeps his conflict very internal. But if we're going to buy that the green-eyed monster as Shakespeare originated is going to be enough to force him into such a state of madness that he kills his own wife, who he loves, based on this jealousy, then I think maybe something a little bigger from Welles might have been helpful here. An actor who we know can get big when he wants to.
Well, yeah, that's pretty fascinating. I was more buying into the story, and I think part of it is that just like in Macbeth, Othello is presenting as a master soldier, somebody who's supposed to be really great in matters of wartime, and thus I kind of thought, hey, it has discipline. He, like, somebody who ends up just raging like a maniac at the slightest hint of jealousy does not seem like the kind of person who would be successful in battles to the extent that the people would lead him. So Welles' subtlety is an interesting choice, and that worked for me because I do see the emotions roil in against him, and Welles does a really nice job of focusing in on Othello's face and top part of his figure and just gives room to settle as the emotions play across his face. Like, the jealousy to me is not a giant propane tank that's been set on fire and like has set him off so much as that it is a skittering flame that just shows up and then he's troubled by it. And then, but then he can let it go, but then it keeps coming back. And those phases of him, of the jealousy affecting him more and more, I think he effectively brings out in the movie.
So, yeah, that is an interesting decision by Welles, and I don't think it undermines the film, although I think it could have been more interesting to see his performance more varied. But what I find more problematic is the use of the Iago character, here played by Michael McLeamore, who is an older actor, definitely older than Welles at this point, and plays Iago as very much this kind of stern and unlikable villain, when what's so powerful about the Iago character is his mystery and his ability to manipulate Othello, and I didn't really buy that Othello could be so easily manipulated by this Iago. Now, there is another version of Othello, a more modern version, certainly with nowhere near the visual flair that Welles brings, but has a performance from Kenneth Branagh. It's Oliver Parker's 1995 version of Othello, with Lawrence Fishburne as Othello and Kenneth Branagh as Iago. And Branagh's performance here, I think, is almost definitive because he really hits home the entire I am not what I am mystery to him, and his joy. What's taken out here also is when he talks directly to the audience and lets us know a little bit more of his mechanisms.
Oh, wait a minute. So it's a little more like a House of Cards kind of thing going on?
Well, you know, House of Cards was loosely based on Richard III. So,
no, I did not.
Yeah. So, yeah, House of Cards took that whole bit from Shakespeare.
Okay.
And Iago is a more subtle villain than Richard III. But it should be a juicier role, and I do think that opportunity was lost. Apparently, Welles decided that Iago's motivation for his hating Othello in this version was that he's impotent, which, yeah.
That's very interesting, especially considering the route that Welles is going to take in certain other supporting characters later on in his filmography. Mm-hmm. Yeah, one thing that Macbeth, I think, has over Othello, or rather Welles' Macbeth versus Welles' Othello, is that Welles' Macbeth had an accompaniment of actors who had a very high to exceptionally high quality of performance. And in Othello, considerably less so. Iago in particular, he does not really bring about anything more than a stern level of glumness upon I vaguely dislike the Moor, and I just don't want him to be happy. And you neither know why he's perpetuating these awful chicanery upon Othello, nor do you really care to know why he's doing it. It's just the guy's a dick.
Right, and that's death for this play, because he shouldn't be a dick. He should be the devil. He should be the little devil on Othello's shoulder who's whispering to him and causing him to go against his very nature, because Othello should be sympathetic at the beginning, and then it's so tragic to see his fall to the point where he loses everything.
Yeah, I want to also point out, though, that when I was watching it, I do like what the text does in terms of the very subtle ways that Iago pricks at Othello's ego. Mm-hmm. Like, this is not a case where he's set up an elaborate Rube Goldberg scheme that has been, like, money-moving parts. He just knows when to subtly guide Othello and point out I'm not saying she's cheating on you. Well, that's not what I'm saying. And that's the very phrasing that puts it in his head.
Right.
I think those subtleties are brought about nicely on the text, but the motivations behind inducing these thoughts just gets lost in not a really great performance.
And because imagine those lines being said by a really charismatic Iago.
Right. And I can't, because I don't know what that would be like. I'd imagine there's multiple ways you can play him, like somebody who's eager to just cause mischief, maybe, or somebody who feels vastly superior to Othello, possibly from a racial connotation.
Exactly, because we should mention that, you know, the language used here is a Moor, but that reads, in our understanding, as Othello is a black man. Now, Moor may have appeared more Arab in the context, but what this play does is really get into some issues of racism and outsiderness, and how no matter how great a soldier Othello is, no matter how accepted in society he seems to be, he is always relegated to this outsider position. And that makes him vulnerable to somebody like Iago because of the color of his skin.
It leads me just to thinking in ways of larger-than-life people who have these exceptional qualities, yet find themselves like constrained or having doubts upon the environment that they find themselves in. Like, even though they're ostensibly accepted by society, I just see a really weird echo between his fugitive Nazi in The Stranger. And now, obviously, I'm not trying to equate Othello with an escaped Nazi. However, I do think that The Stranger was a bit of a comic bits about, like, how does he try to accommodate being a nice teacher in this upper crust kind of environment, and this case of acceptance in this high society, because Desdemona is the daughter of a senator, so he has attained now a measure of prominence, but nevertheless he is the only Moor. I believe it's the only Moor in that particular environment.
Right.
So,
or at least at that level of leadership.
That's right. So he has this level of respect, but undercutting all that is a feeling of not belonging. Something that, like, Iago is able to
prey on
and prod and induce. And I think, at least in Welles' portrayal here, it's that very sense of, I don't even feel the level of jealousy coming in, honestly. And part of that is because the lady playing Desdemona, Suzanne Cloutier, she does, to me, okay, by being someone who is very much a goody-two-shoes, who is righteously aghast mm-hmm. at what Othello is suggesting for her, and just maybe a little kind of naive. There's really not a lot of awareness of the danger she finds herself in until it's way too late, of course. Right. And mostly she's just nice and has nothing but the best of intentions to, like, to talk to Cassio, blissfully unaware, you know. So I took Othello as more of a case, and maybe this is in context of Welles' career, as a case of self-immolation, you see? Like something of a guy who just ultimately feels he does not belong in this environment, and it's just, he's just pushed to the level where he will just destroy it.
Hmm. Yeah, that's a really good reading of it. And, you know, and I think you can have a lot of motivations for that, whether it be being the victim of racism or, you know, having this inner jealousy come out in the most extreme way. We should mention before we kind of leave the race issue that being a film made in 1951, Orson Welles plays the role in blackface, which would have been just the normal standard of the time, even though it is rightly be unacceptable today.
Well, and but yet it achieves this kind of super weird meta level when you watch, at least when I watch it, mm-hmm. because this is a guy who's not comfortable in his dark skin. Mm-hmm. And so playing a guy who isn't that color naturally is does kind of the level of discomfort kind of maybe matches our own perspective on, like, yeah, man, I shouldn't be like this either, you know?
Yeah, it suited his performance, but it's good that it is no longer.
Yeah. One thing that I really enjoy about this movie is that this is kind of one of the most noirish German expressionistic takes of a 100-year-old story that I've seen. Because Welles uses these locations to such really great effect. Whereas, I guess part of the staginess of Macbeth also was shown how it was basically, like, lit in a kind of stage-like manner. Mm-hmm. But here, there's moments of just these great expressionist touches. Like, what, like when Othello realizes the scope of what he's done, for example, he is behind the most narrow, tallest jail bars you have ever seen. They mm-hmm. look like they're three stories high, for one, just take one example.
Right. Or look at the scene in the bathhouse, which turned out was filmed in a bathhouse because the costumes hadn't arrived on time. But
nice.
This is the scene where Iago murders Rodrigo. Rodrigo is hiding underneath some wooden rafters, and Iago is chasing him around with this dagger. And in what, in lesser hands, could have read as a pretty silly action sequence, actually becomes one of the highlights of the film.
Yeah, because I think he stabs or, like, superimposed while the camera's adjusting, like, this angle and that, and it's superimposing, so he's like he's stabbing hundreds of times, but yet all at once.
Right, right.
Yeah, and the way he uses both the, like, the water of the bathhouse, the water of the catacombs that are underlying this castle fortress, and I even love how he manages to use these birds. Not until Hitchcock in his bird-based movie have, like, these gulls been this kind of wonderfully avian chorus to Iago's machinations and Othello's paranoia, to just have him caw, 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 caw in the background. In fact, I think there's several shots where they appear to be, like, floating right behind Iago as if he has summoned them.
Right.
Welles has made so effective use of that location. It's astounding when you just hear, like, how he was, like, across four countries, and he still manages to make it look like a whole consistent work, which is, that's a pretty impressive miracle, you know, in and of itself. But in terms of the presentation of Othello, it kind of sounds to me that, like, you'd kind of would place this as some of the less adequate representations, right? Is that kind of accurate?
Well, you know, I'm very torn because mm-hmm. I'm so blown away by the visuals and the filmmaking that I want to give it all the credit in the world, but also kind of maybe a disadvantage of having seen a lot of different Othellos is I did also notice what was missing.